Happy Sunday, and thank you so much for tuning in to Nike TV. Now, I thought today's episode was going to be a death on a dirt road, but as it turns out, nobody passed away in this case. Thank you, God. So, this is going to be a Nike Investigates episode due to those facts. Now, I do know one of the perpetrators involved, and I have spoken with them extensively, so I will include my thoughts on her. However, once again, this cannot be a death on a dirt road because they didn't actually kill anybody. Now, they got the same amount of time, but no one died. I got a request from two different people asking me to do this case. Now, although this was an earlier one, since it happened back in the 70s, I do believe, there aren't a lot of photos, and I do not like doing cases like that. I mean, but I do understand why they're not archived, and you probably can go back in the newspaper.com archives and find some photos or find the actual story about what happened, but most of what I'm getting is from the court system. It's from the archived records of the state of South Carolina versus this particular person and their co-defendant. So that's where my information from this case is coming from. Today's Nike Investigates is all about Elizabeth Paris and her co-defendant Nathan Joseph Jones. Now, fun fact, Elizabeth Paris is also the name of a Salem witch trial accuser back in those times when the Salem witch trials actually were going forth. She accused some people of being witches back then. As a result, every time I went to do an image search, I couldn't find anything except for this little girl who had gone on to accuse these people of being witches. And they got like 20 people killed back in their time. So that was crazy to me, but not as crazy as what you're about to hear. Let me not forget to add that this Elizabeth Paris was only 9 years old when she caused the death of those 20 Salem residents, along with her cousin Abigail Williams. 19 were hanged and one was pressed to death. Elizabeth Paris is not looking good for anybody. Moving on, in the early morning hours of November 29th, 1977, Michelle Ray Squillante was abducted at knife point by two assailants, one male and one female. Those two assailants then drove to a secluded area where they proceeded to take turns assaulting, battering, and sexually assaulting young Michelle. They then robbed her and slashed her throat. Michelle, who had thankfully survived, gave officers a description of both of her assailants along with a description of the vehicle that all of this had occurred in. There was also a gas station attendant who had seen the vehicle and its occupants. Officers then located a vehicle matching the description given by the victim as well as the gas station attendant. They found it at a house whose occupants were confirmed to be that of Elizabeth Paris and Nathan Joseph Jones. Jones was arrested after he attempted to pull out of the driveway after he noticed police surveillance around the home. Once he was stopped, he showed the officers identification, which showed him having a full beard as Michelle Squillante had described him to have. He did not have it at the time of the stop. Regardless, Nathan Jones was arrested and Elizabeth Paris was arrested following that. The arrests were made later on in the same day that the crimes had been committed. The record showed that Nathan Jones and his brother tried to hurriedly remove a suitcase from the car and then left it there once they noticed the police surveillance. Investigators noted that the opportunity for search was fleeting, so they hurriedly moved upon the car to go ahead and get whatever they could get prior to obtaining a search warrant. The victim had made photographic identification of her assailants. The reliability of Michelle Squillante's identification of her attacker came under fire. However, the prosecution argued that had she been a passerby, then maybe. But because she had spent more than an hour and a half with those two, and because she was the victim of the crime, her identification was spot on and it could be trusted. Add to that the fact that only a 2-week time period had passed between the attack and the photo lineup. Those facts would come into question during the appeals process for both Elizabeth Paris and Nathan Joseph Jones. Furthermore, the procedure of dentition was used to compare bite marks on the victim's body to those of her assailant. It had only previously been used to identify bite marks or to identify deceased individuals, but this was a new procedure at the time. It became widely known that fingerprints, like dentition, is unique to those who possess them. The bite marks were said to undoubtedly belong to Nathan Jones. She submitted to those crimes under the duress of both the knife and her attackers. She testified that during the rape, She saw the knife in the hands of the female attacker, Elizabeth Paris. After they both were satisfied with the sexual assault, Michelle was taken from the car, her ring was removed, and she was knocked to the ground. Nathan Jones then slashed Michelle Squillante's throat. Then they returned to the car and left the scene with the victim's pocketbook and other belongings. Michelle Squillante was left for dead in that secluded area. Suffice it to say, both were charged and convicted of a number of offenses, including but not limited to criminal sexual conduct in the first degree, assault and battery with intent to kill, armed robbery, as well as kidnapping. They were both given life in prison with the possibility of parole since they were sentenced under the old law. And again, Michelle did survive, though I'm sure without some form of PTSD. In a conversation with Elizabeth Parrish, she did inform me that Nathan Joseph Jones did pass away after a battle with AIDS. So I don't know how reliable that information is, but that did come from the horse's mouth. Elizabeth was set to go up for parole before I left the Department of Corrections altogether, or before I left Camille Griffin Graham. She did come to me and ask me about housing and just different resources because she was expecting to make parole. I'm not sure. I can't remember exactly if this was her first time going up, but I know she was going up for parole and she was expecting to have to do that somewhere in the near future. And she was looking for, you know, different things out in the community. And I don't know exactly what she was planning on doing since she is in a wheelchair at this point, but I just have to say, as far as Elizabeth is concerned, I did know her well. She went over to Leith Correctional Institution for a while, and then she came back to Camille Graham. She told the best stories, okay? She used to tell me if I needed a good laugh or I needed some nostalgia, I would go to Liz, or she would come and talk to me in the office, and she would tell me all about how the department used to be, how back then they could wear their regular clothes, they could smoke on the yard. She would tell me, she would regale me with all types of stories. She also told me the story of what happened with her, and she stated that she did not understand how she got a life sentence for a crime where nobody died. And although I have my own thoughts and feelings about it, you know, I never imposed on how she felt because I just didn't feel like it was my place to. Now, a lot of us might feel like what they did was enough. They slit the girl's throat and they left her for dead. They robbed her on top of that, and they both took turns sexually assaulting her. That was bad in and of itself. But couple that with the fact that this woman has to go through, or had to go through, life with those thoughts and memories in her head probably constantly, I feel like she's serving a life sentence as well. Nathan Joseph Jones, he got the easy way out, if you ask me. He died with AIDS, and I'm sure that was a battle within itself, but you know, karma doesn't always come back the way you put it out there. You know, again, Elizabeth is in a wheelchair. She's had some health challenges over the years. She can be a lot for a lot of people, and I know some people who did not think that highly of her, and they probably still don't, because she is one of those people who just don't take a lot. You know, they get angry often. They're going to speak up. She's an old head. You know, she's one of the longest serving female inmates in the state of South Carolina. I think the longest right now is Earlene Young. And I do plan to do a story on her. As a matter of fact, I recorded her story as a podcast and it would not allow me to export it. So I'm going to have to go back and do that story all over again. That's a very interesting one. So stay tuned. But getting back to Elizabeth, there's not much information on her out there on the web other than her Supreme Court filings and her appeals process, along with Nathan Joseph Jones. Of course, they were in separate prisons, but their appeals went through together. So I'm thinking maybe they had the same attorney. I know they were tried together. According to Elizabeth, Michelle Squillante did have some dealings with law enforcement of her own. I'm not going to go into that at the risk of, you know, disrespecting the victim here in this case. But I will say that this was a hard one to deal with. You know, they did abduct her. They did do what they wanted to. And this was bizarre. This was very bizarre. I mean, I guess the blessing in all of it is that she did not lose her life. And to be honest with you, I'm not sure if she is dead or alive at this point, but I do feel for her. You know, nobody deserves what she had to go through. Elizabeth does remain in prison to this day. That parole hearing, I believe, is coming up maybe next year or the year after that, but she was trying to get an early jump on things. You know, South Carolina Parole Board, I sat in a lot of those proceedings, and they like to say that parole is denied due to the nature and seriousness of the crime, that is never going to change. You know, these people who have been in prison for this number of years, especially people who have health challenges such as Elizabeth Parris, I feel like maybe they would do well in maybe a rehabilitation facility, maybe not put them back out there in society, because they are institutionalized. Let's just be real. You know, they've done over 40 years in prison. Her in particular, she's done over 40 years in prison. So I don't even believe she would know how the world works. And again, she can't walk that well on her own. She is not like bound to a wheelchair 24/7. She can get up and walk it if she wants to, or she can walk short distances, but still, you know, she has some health challenges, some things with her legs. I do believe that she would do well from rehabilitation, because the prison system just does not do that. That's just the God's honest truth about that situation. However, you know, it was weird to me as well when she told me her story and I realized that nobody had passed away. Nobody died in this situation. So the fact that they were given life in prison, you know, when some murderers get like 35 years day for day, they get 30 years. I've seen some with 10 years for murder. I mean, it just all depends. And then you have to understand that, again, that was the old law. That was back then when a lot of things were not understood. A lot of things were not happening that much, you know, out there in society. So they really had no idea how to deal with it other than locking these people away for good so that they did not have to worry about this out in society. I get it. I understand, you know, but if you're going to do it for one, maybe do it for the majority. I don't know. I'm on the fence about the prison system, to be honest with you guys. I'm really on the fence about it. How much does it rehabilitate these inmates? Are they going to benefit from being locked away for the rest of their lives? Or do we get the benefit out here in society? Because some people, sadly, they just do not change. You know, they remain who they were prior to being locked up. And we never know what people are thinking. Sociopaths, psychopaths, antisocial personality disorder, those things really do exist. It's not just stuff that you hear in the movies. I mean, but prison just doesn't do a good job of ridding people of those qualities and those traits about themselves. They don't, they medicate them to death, you know, and then they put them out there and they give them all these psychotropic medicines and it's really heavy stuff. And then they end up with ailments and disorders like tardive dyskinesia, where they're slapping themselves and they can't stop moving for reasons unknown, you know, and that's just it. They medicate the problem, they pacify the problem, but they really don't do anything to rid the problem. So, I mean, I just don't know how good prison and jail works other than the fact that they are not out there in society. And maybe that's a benefit within itself. I don't know. But as far as Liz Parris, I would like to see her out there in society. I would like to see her having, you know, the second half of her life. I think back then she was on a lot of drugs. Drugs are a disease. They are an ailment. And you can't just argue that for your family members and not other people. I mean, it's a sickness. And again, some people are 50-50 about that. You know, people can understand it on the one hand when it's their loved ones, but on the other hand, they cannot understand that drugs make you do some crazy things. They really, really do. You know, I can't personally attest, but I've seen it. You know, I've seen a thing or two, and a thing or two. You know, she used to tell me how in the prison you could get any kind of drug that you wanted out there on the yard. And guess what? That came back around full circle, because you still can. You can get anything you want out there on the yard. And I'm not going to talk about how it comes in, because that's another story. That's another Nike Investigates all in itself. But I will say that, you know, there were reasons, and then there were reasons. You know, she has her opinions about the victim. Again, I'm not going to go into that at the risk of disrespecting the victim. That is not my intent here. But it still did not justify the means of which, you know, it did not justify what her and Nathan Jones put that young lady through, regardless of what they felt about her, regardless of what she had done in her past. Nobody deserves that. But I'm going to go ahead and end this episode of Nike Investigates here. I hope you guys enjoyed this. This was not a very long case, because again, there's not that much information out there. I will get back to doing longer cases as soon as I find some who have a lot of information. Google sucks. Let me just say that. Google is not the best search engine. They have so many protective interests, and so they really give you a bunch of crap You know, they give you a lot of things that you have to dig through to really find what you are looking for to really produce a quality video. And again, when I put Elizabeth Parris's name in, the only thing that came up was the young lady from the Salem witch trials, as well as her cousin, Abigail Williams. And while that was tragic, that just wasn't what I was looking for. So hopefully, you know, I can do something better for you guys in the future. As far as this segment is concerned, you guys really respond to Death on the Dirt Road, and I really appreciate that. But, you know, I got to push some of these other segments forward so that, you know, my channel can have some diversity. But again, I hope you guys enjoy your Sunday. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll definitely see you guys in the next one. P.S. If you happen to stumble upon this video, I challenge you to tell at least one person about Nike TV. Just one. I'm trying to grow my subscriber count. I'm at like 276 at this present moment. And while I am dedicated to this channel, I'm just trying to get to an even number, you know, a cool little 300. So if you guys could do that for me, I would greatly appreciate it. If not, I still thank you for being here. I'm not in the business of forcing people to do anything for me, but that's just my sincere ask of you all.